Namaskar, hello, greetings, welcome to this introductory tutorial about how to use a typical HPC cluster. And this particular video is made for the North Bengal University HPC cluster, and that's an IBM Power PC, but in general it can be used by other users for similar type of architectures and similar type of HPC clusters in other universities as well. So let's start this introductory tutorial. And first I will show you this diagram, which is not strictly in the computer science term a block diagram, but basically it gives an idea of the workings of HPC for an end user, so even a layman can understand this. So it is a very simplified diagram. So basically in a campus we have end users, students, faculties, research scholars, a lot of people who can use the HPC, and they can either be connected to the campus LAN when they're in the campus or the hostels, for example, or if they're working from home, they will be in an external internet service provider network, and you can directly connect to this master node. In some cases it is called the login node of the HPC cluster, directly through the campus LAN or maybe through a VPN tunnel. So this master node, also known as the login node, is basically just the interface of the HPC computing nodes to the outer world. So the computation of a HPC is carried out on computing nodes, and that's where the calculations should be done, and never on the master node, which is only for storing your personal files related to the calculations. So calculations should never be run on the master node, because that would just jeopardize the entire framework, make it slow, and it can crash the whole system. So the master node is connected through a InfiniBand network to all these different computing nodes. Say for example we have these 28 nodes, and there are names of those nodes like compute 000, 001, 002 and like, and calculations are carried out in these nodes, and they communicate all the time back and forth with the master node, and that's how you get your calculation results and all the things. So first step is to create an user account for using any HPC system. You have to go to the administrator, complete the formalities. You will get a user ID and a password, and also the IP address for the cluster. So once you have these details with you, you can log in to the HPC. In case you need access from off-campus location, say through VPN, so you would also need, in addition to the HPC account, a VPN account. So first, using the VPN, you will log into the campus LAN, and then you can access the HPC. And in some cases, you have this VPN specific IP address for the HPC. So the HPC IP address from the campus LAN may be different from the IP address you need to use when you are logging through VPN. So one has to keep that in mind. And how to log in? If you are using Linux, it is very simple and very secure. You can do this SSH to the, this is your username and this is your IP address. So open the terminal, I'll just type this kind of a command. So it will securely log you in to the HPC. It will ask for your username and password sometimes. And then there is the question of file transfer. So for file transfer, what you need to do basically is two-way from your local system, which is this or this, into this master node. You need to copy your files and simulation results back and forth. So for that purpose, this command is useful, secure copy SCP. You give the username at the IP address. So this is the HPC IP address. This is the username created for you, and you give the exact path to the file, and then you give the path on your local system where you want to copy the file. And this is for the other way around. From your local system, you are copying some file to your account on the HPC. For Windows, use PuTTY. This is a very useful client and a free software. And here you have to input the IP address given to you by the admin and the port. And when you log in using this open, select this SSH type of login, and you will be prompted for username password. In some universities, there are also RSA key authentication for added security. But in this particular case, there is no such thing. For Windows, if you want to do file transfer back and forth from your local system to the master, how to do that is you download this free software, WinSCP, and there you have a very nice interface. You can drag and drop files back and forth. So it will securely copy your files from the user account on the HPC to your local system. And it is important to understand that these software like PuTTY or WinSCP only needs to be on your personal computer, not the HPC user account. So only on the endpoint you need it, not on the HPC account. Next comes the important aspect of installing software or packages. So for anything you want to do on HPC, you have to contact the system administrator and tell them about the specific software you may need. First check if it is already installed on the framework. Next point, never to use any pirated or cracked software on HPC, as it can compromise the whole setup and also lead to legal action for copyright violations. Most HPCs would be running on Linux system. So it is very important that one as a user gets himself or herself familiarized with the Linux or Unix system before working on HPCs. You have to know the basic commands, how Linux operates. And then a very important aspect that is, if you are going to use a licensed software or even open source software, it is highly imperative, it is always important to make sure to download only the parallel version and not the serial version, because HPC is a parallel framework. It is it gives you the advantage of parallel computing. And most commercial softwares, scientific softwares, they are available sometimes in parallel, sometimes also in serial. So the companies offer both kind of versions. But if you do not have the parallel version, then it is of no use operating in an HPC. It would give you, if you are using a serial version on a HPC cluster, it would be unable to take any advantage of the parallel computing, and you would get a performance something worse than a desktop. It won't be better than a desktop. So for HPC, a parallel license, a parallel software is must. And always one has to study the user manual for the instructions and discuss with the admin how to install and uninstall that software in your user account. And one has to be a bit careful, because the facility belongs to everyone, the institute, and all rules and regulations have to be followed. So for running calculations, as I already said, that computing nodes are for the calculation, and master or login node is only for the purpose of logging into the system. So it is the interface of the HPC to the outer world. So the user will log into the master node, and from there he will launch the calculation into the computing nodes, not on the master node locally. So no calculation should be ever attempted on the master node locally. So next, because that can crash the system and the entire framework will be useless for all the users. So next, very important do not is not to log into the individual computing nodes and run jobs locally, because HPC will always have a job manager, and the job manager needs to know what jobs are running on which nodes and all these things. So a job should only be submitted through a specific job manager and not individually on a computing node by a user himself or herself. Another very important point is not to unnecessarily fill up the storage with files which are unrelated to calculations. So not to fill up the disk space, because disk space is limited and it is a shared resource between a number of users. All the users who use the HPC use that space, so there would be some allocations for every user and one should not exceed that. Now for running calculations, first step is to create a shell script file with the necessary commands specific to the program, the software you are going to use for running those calculations. And all these calculations have to be submitted only through a proper job management framework. For example, Slurm, we have in the NBU HPC, it uses the Slurm job manager. There are other HPCs which use Torque, MAUI, SGE and such other job managers, but here I will limit my discussion only to the Slurm. So after understanding how the job manager works, one has to read the manual a little bit, and only then one should try to launch a job through this job manager and not locally into the computing nodes. So you log into the master node, create a shell script file with necessary commands for the calculation. You'll have your input files, and in the same directory you should have the script file, and then you have to launch it through the job manager. So how to do that, I'm just going to give a brief overview. And another important fact is, after each set of calculations are done, one has to clean the temporary directory. This is this TMP from your temporary files, and you can, in Linux, you can just use this cd tmp and then rmrf start dot start to clean all your files. You will only be able to clean your files, but it is always important to clean the temp directory after each set of simulations. So now, talking about the job manager, we have here this Slurm, and if you are in another university, you have to contact your admin. You have to know which job manager you are going to use. And for Slurm, there are certain specific set of commands. I'll just, in a nutshell, I have put in some commands for you for Slurm. One has to obviously study the Slurm manual to know about all the commands, but these are the basic function commands that you need, basic functional commands to get on with the job. So sinfo, this will show you the status of the available nodes, which nodes are available, which are down, which are busy, these kind of things. And sbash, very important, you will be using sbash to run your job scripts. So this submits the job to the queue, to the job manager queuing system and batch job submission system. Srun is a command which afterwards, say you have a software specific command for running your calculation, and before that you put srun, so that will run a task. Sq will show you the queue, the running jobs, the ones that are held in queue that will be released later, and this kind of things. And if you have put a job by mistake, you have made some mistake in the input file and you want to cancel that job, you have to do this scancel with the job ID. You have to know the job ID. So I will just show you in the next screens how to do this. And important is, if you have in an other university you are using an account, there might be Torque, SGE, MAUI or this kind of things. And for Torque, the commands equivalent to this Q would be qstat, for this sbatch would be qsub, scancel would be qdel and such. But let's focus on the Slurm. So what a job script would look like, I have put a screenshot of a typical job script. So it's all these lines are important, you have to put all of them, and they would begin with this hash exclamation mark bin bash sbatch command is there, p debug. So this is very important, dash n too. So this sort of tells the job manager how many number of nodes at most you are going to need for your job, and that is very important, and this should match this in this srun command. This, if this 2 here, it's also should be n2, and never put a very high number because then your job will get delayed. So 2 is typical. This is a job description name, and this is the srun command. So dash n, this is a flag, and 10 is the number of MPI processes you want to launch, and this is number of computing nodes you are going to use, and this is your path to the executable of the program. So you have to put the entire path of the executable to the program you are going to use. I have just used a fictitious name, program.proc.sh, and then you will have your input file. So this is how typically a Quantum Espresso or this kind of softwares have the command for running those software. So you have an input file and you would have to specify the output file. So you specify the input and output file, but also make sure to point to the correct path of your executable. So one has to save such a job as, say, jobscript.sh, a shell script, and preferably in the same directory whether you want to run the calculation, where you have your input files, where you want to have your results and of the calculations, in the same directory put the jobscript.sh. You can make it executable by the command chmod plus x jobscript.sh. Space should be there between this chmod and plus x and here also. And now that you have set up everything, just run the command sbatch jobscript.sh. So this will submit your job through the Slurm job manager on the parallel environment, and the calculations would run on the computing nodes. You don't have to worry about anything. It will do the calculations, it will collect the data back into your user account and put the save the files there as you have specified in your input file or in your software. So that's what it does, and that's how to use a job script with Slurm. And now that you have submitted a job, you would need a command sq to view the status of the job, whether your job is running or is it queued or is it held or something like that, or is it pending. So you can, once the job has been successfully submitted, you will get a one line message that job has been submitted, and then you will get a job ID. This is important. You will get a job ID for your job which you just submitted, and then you can just check with this SQ, and also from time to time, even long time after submitting the job, how it is running, because jobs on HPC would take time because it's something you'd obviously put something computationally demanding, so it will take some time. So you can time to time also log in back into the system and check how your job is progressing or this kind of things. And this is a typical screenshot, and you see some of the jobs. This R, this means the job is running, this is the status. PD means pending, and why it is pending? Because resources. So when the SQ intelligently distributes the job among the different nodes, considering the computational load that is, and it has to know which jobs have been submitted. So all the jobs should be submitted only and only through SQ, only through the Slurm. So that is the with the sbatch command. So only through Slurm the job should be submitted like I have described here, and not on your own. So it will know, and it will also have the option to queue your job. So if all the various nodes are busy or some resources are not available at the time, so it will just put it on hold, and whenever it becomes free, it will do your job. So this is very important, and to know more, do study the Slurm manual online for more details, more options. There are many more tips and tricks that are beyond the scope of this small introduction. And enjoy high performance computing. You can carry out calculations from computational chemistry, computational material science, computational biology, mathematics, multi-physics simulations and whatnot. So one has to follow the guidelines, one has to understand how to operate this HPC, and then the possibilities are endless. And I thank you everyone for your time, and this particular video tutorial was made by me for the University of North Bengal Computer Center. And if you need any further information, do contact the administrators at the NBU Computer Center. And many thanks. Goodbye.